Yeah, I think Brother Nick just touched on, we have an expectation. Everybody, you wake up in the morning, you have an expectation?
Amen.
Right? We all start with an expectation of, you know, what's going to unfold for the day. Maybe it's work, maybe it's whatever, but you start every day with an expectation, right? I start every day with an expectation. I say, yeah, I'm looking for a greater expectation. Now, to do that, I don't know about you, but I like to start my day with the news. The good news, of course, right? That's how I start my day, because then if I look at the news, what does the news have to say? What does the good news have to say? I believe I will have an understanding of what that expectation is for the day and for my life. But it has to start with the good news, so I believe that. Now, there are other newspapers, and I don't really read newspapers, but a lot of times when I travel, and I'm in a hotel room, when you wake up in the morning, there is a paper at your door. They actually give you a paper so you can start the day with the news. And it's usually for business travelers, and the USA Today is intended for the business travelers. Because it's the same paper, whether you're in New York, Florida, California, it doesn't matter where you are, wherever you're traveling, Mr. Business Traveler, you all have the same paper, and you have the news of the day. You know, but this one struck me this Friday, and this is the USA Today for its Friday's paper. But what struck me was I saw the word forgive. And that's a good way to start the day, right? I said, hey, you know, forgive, okay. But as I looked at the USA Today on Friday, it said, can you forgive? Can you forgive? Now, just so we're clear, the answer to that question is absolutely, without a shadow of a doubt, yes. Jesus Christ said, you have the power to forgive men's sins, trespasses, those that have offended you. I have given you the power to do that. So that's an answered question. Jesus Christ answered the question. But what I find interesting is the reason this has surfaced is it's amidst the new discoveries of what? Lance Armstrong. And so I'm sure Lance was real happy to pick up the paper on Friday morning. But what I found interesting also was as I looked at it, and then I unfolded it, well, there was a picture of Lance. There's a picture of Tiger Wood, not Tiger Lou. Amen, brother? Tiger Wood. There's a picture of Michael Vick, Arnold Schwarzenegger, Martha Stewart, poor Martha Stewart, and Bernie Madoff. And it's like, wow, can we forgive? And again, the answer is yes. The answer is absolutely yes. But you know what all of these have in common to me? They're all yesterday's news. It's all yesterday's news. You see, and that's what happens. And what are people doing? Well, they're trying to find fault. But I got to go back to get it, right? Even with Lance Armstrong, they were testing his blood from the year 2000. I think the last race he had was in like 06 or 07 or whatever, right? So I had to go back and get that. And then they're bringing up Martha Stewart. That was like, what, 2002? That was 10 years ago. You see, yes, we can forgive, but we also need to forget because Hebrews says that he remembers our sins no more. He doesn't plaster it on the USA Today. Thank God he doesn't do that. Thank God he gives us a much better paper, a much better newspaper to read. He says, hey, that's yesterday. It's yesterday's news. You see, but that's the problem. They're finding fault. They're finding fault. And what happens? Why do we find fault? Well, Hosea says we find fault because we have a divided heart. You see, the divided heart finds fault. And what's the divided heart? Well, it's not the heart of the Father. And this is a new year. We're talking about the heart of the Father. So sometimes you have to talk about what it's not. Sometimes when I have an understanding of what it's not, oh, okay, I let go of that because that's not what it is. Well, it's not a divided heart. The heart of the Father is not divided. Because a divided heart on days will say, I forgive. But then maybe years later, I'm going to print it in the newspaper again and I'm going to remember it. That's a divided heart. You see, I forgave, but then I chose not to forget it and bring it back. Well, that's divided. Because there's a day there's forgiveness, but then there's a day you just choose not to forget. Well, you forgive some, but you don't forgive others. Because the fact of the matter is, at work, it was funny, you know, kind of the water cooler discussions. Well, certain folks forgave this one. That wasn't so bad, right? Martha Stewart wasn't so bad. We forgave her. But not Lance Armstrong. And so we pick and choose, you know, based on the offense, based on the fault that we find.
You see, but the divided heart will find fault. And so that's why we have to live with the Father's heart. We have to live with the true heart, the true nature, and the character that's inside of us so that we don't find the fault. Because we say, you know what, it's yesterday's news. And the fact is, as we sit here today at whatever time it is, on this Sunday morning, every offense that has happened to you and I is what? Yeah, it's yesterday's news. It's just like that newspaper. It's gone. Thank you, Lord. Right. Thank you, Lord. So I believe the divided heart is just that. It finds fault. But we got to deal with the Father's heart where there is no fault. You know, they brought Jesus Christ in front of Pilate. And Pilate asked him, he said, hey, you were the king of the Jews? And he says, yes. And he says, but I bear witness to the truth. And Pilate said, what is the truth? What is truth? I just find that to be a very profound question this morning. What is truth? Now, Jesus Christ said, I am the way and the truth and the life. So the truth is Christ. I bear witness to Christ.
Amen.
And that's what Jesus was saying. I bear witness to truth. What is truth? I ask you the question. Is it the yesteryear, the yesterday's news? Or the fact that you have your Father's heart, the fact that the Spirit of Christ dwells inside you, is that truth? You see, because sometimes we'll say, but the facts. You don't got your facts straight. All right, give me the facts. And we look to the facts. Right? Isn't that what they do in the court of law? Facts. What were their office on Friday saying in Dragnet? Facts, man. Nothing but the facts. And that's what the woman does. That's what our soul is. The woman inside wants. We need the facts. Just the facts. Just give me the facts. That's not the truth. That's not the truth. You see, and we confuse the facts and the truth. I can tell you the sky is green outside today. Now, that's a fact. I said that. Does it make it a truth?
No.
No. It's blue. And so we have to realize when we're talking about the true character, the true nature, the heart of the Father, is Christ inside of us. There is no fault. Because what did Pilate say? I find no fault in him. Right, you can't find fault in Christ. It's a spotless lamb. It is without blemish. It is innocent. There is no fault. That's the heart of the Father. Even Pilate realized there's no fault in this man. Who crucified him? The church. Crucified him. Pilate didn't. Pilate sat down on the phone. Church said crucified him. Why? Well, they were looking at, you know, they found the fault. They found the things, you know, he did the good works on the Sabbath. He said he was the Son of God. He blasphemed, he this, he that. And then they found fault. The divided heart will always find fault. But that's not the heart we have now. We have the heart of the Father. You have the heart of Christ. And so it's not about the divided heart. We don't find fault. We don't find fault. But let me ask you something. If I don't find fault, is it possible then, if I have the heart of a Father, the true heart of the Father, is it possible for me to be offended? Yeah, maybe there are days where I do feel there's an offense. But I pray, if that is the case, that God just wakes me up and says, Phil, behold, be not offended. That's what Jesus Christ told his disciples. Jesus Christ told him this. He said, listen, they're going to hate you, they hate me. But you got to bear witness to the truth, he told them. You got to bear witness to the truth, he told his disciples that. And then after that, he said, be not offended. Don't find fault. Don't take offense. Why? Because they just don't understand? Don't take offense to that. See, because that's all that is. That's what the trespass is. That's what the offense is. It's just a lapse from the truth. Listen, Lance Armstrong, listen, it was a lapse from the truth, brother. Christ dwells inside you. You just didn't realize that, man. You just didn't realize that. Martha Stewart, the Spirit of Christ dwells inside of you. That lapse from the truth, it was just that. It was just a momentary lapse. That's why you got to leave it in yesterday. It's okay. You just didn't realize that. I take no offense. The minute we take offense, though, we start to find faults, and then we have these issues, and we got these problems, and that's a divided heart. That's not the heart of a father. And so, when Jesus Christ himself says to the disciples, which, do we have any disciples in the house this morning? Okay, thank you, Brother Mike. Big bunch in the house. Yeah, we're all disciples. When he tells me, Phil, be not offended, then I know, because I have the heart of the Father, that I can live that life. That I don't have to find find the offense. I don't have to find the fault. Because once I find this fault, then I usually am offended. And God's saying, no. No, that's not that. You got the heart of the Father. You're not the divided heart. There is no fault. That's not who you are. That's not the true heart.
I'd like to share a few passages in Matthew 18. And this is Jesus Christ who's talking with the disciples. And essentially what this chapter is dealing with is offenses. Those that are offended. So he starts off, he says this. He said, "Verily I say unto you, except ye be converted and become as little children, ye shall not enter the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, who shall humble himself as a little child, the same is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. But whoso shall offend one of these, my little ones, which believe in me, it were better if a millstone were hung around your neck and be drowned in the depth of the sea." And so what he's saying there is that word converted. Anybody being converted? He's saying you have to change. You have to change the way you're thinking. You have to be converted. Why? So that you don't offend these little ones. Because who is the greatest? The one that is humble. That's what he just said. See, the humble one, the one that is like Christ, the truly humble one, they won't find the offense. They won't. Because what happens when you do? When you do that, well, it says, listen, you're better off taking that millstone and casting it into the sea. And that millstone, by the way, is just the stone that they used to crush the grain. But you know who had to push that millstone? A mule. It's just your carnal mind. You got to get rid of that. You got to cast it into the sea. You got to get rid of that way of thinking. Because otherwise you're going to find offenses. You're going to find problems. And you can't live with the heart of the Father. You're going to be divided. It's going to be separated. And didn't he say a kingdom divided cannot stand? What kingdom do you think he's talking about now? What kingdom? The kingdom that's inside of you. That divided heart. It can't stand. And so he's going to get rid of that divided kingdom until there's one kingdom. It's just the kingdom of God. That's inside you, just the heart of the Father that's inside you. And so that's what he's doing. But it goes on here and says in verse 7, "But woe unto the world because of offenses." You see, and that's where our woe comes from. That's where our trouble comes from. That's where our sorrow comes from. Because if you start seeing offenses, look what they've done to me, then you have woe, you have trouble, you have sorrow. So it's not about the offenses, because Jesus Christ said, "Be not offended." Why? Because I don't want you to be crying and be in pain and be in sorrow and all this other stuff. So he says, but woe. Because that's where the woe is. And who's finding the offense? Well, it's usually us because we're finding the fault. And so we're offended. We're offended. What they have done to me. And even then, you look at these folks in the paper. Realistically, any of them, they had no impact on me. Yet there are people that talk about this at work and they don't forgive them. It's like they have no impact in their life. What they did, yeah, okay, it was wrong, but how does that impact your life? How does that hurt you? The silliness of it. It really is. It's just childish thinking, really. It's just a childish way. Which, praise God, we know he's getting rid of that, amen? And then he goes on to say, "Wherefore, if thy hand or foot offend thee, cut them off and cast it from thee. For it is better to enter into life halt or maimed rather than having two hands or two feet and being cast into the everlasting fire." Oh, we have twisted this one. I know I did. Ooh, I don't know what we want to cut. We were cutting things off. I don't know if I'm getting in the fire. Maybe I should have no hand. I don't know what. Well, what is he saying here now? Because he's talking about the offenses now. So what is he saying? Listen, if I have a divided heart, then chances are I have divided feet. Some days I walk like Christ, some days I don't. So maybe that day where I don't walk like Christ, where I maybe find Lance guilty, find fault, he's saying, you know what, why don't you get rid of that one? Why don't you cut that lifestyle off and get rid of it? Because that's what we're talking about with feet. We're talking about the lifestyle, the walk. How do you walk your life? Is it judgmental? Do you find fault? I mean, we can always find fault. Isn't it amazing? Look at all the wonderful things that all those people off Lance Chris, by the way, they all give away tons of money. You know, even Lance, he has the Live Strong Foundation. I was listening to a guy on the radio the other day, and it was a Christian radio station, but he started off with a prayer. He said, "Lord, have mercy on him. Lord, have mercy. How about you have some mercy on him?" He trashed his foundation and everything else. You know what? How many lives that foundation has touched? Thousands of lives were touched. People were given financial money so that they could pay for medical bills and things like that. I mean, that's
That was true to me. If I was one of those families that received help, and my child was able to go to the hospital and receive the care, I don't know, that seems like a good thing to me. But they just trashed it all. Why? Because they found something in his blood from the year 2000. See, but the divided heart will do that. Now, of course, that's a good thing. He's helping families. He's touching lives. That's a good thing. Why can't we look at that instead of going to look at the dirty blood? Man. Thank God it's yesterday's news. Amen.
He said that thy eye offend thee. Pluck it out and cast it from thee. But it's better to enter life.
And the same thing. Because the eye, we're talking about understanding. We're understanding. And sometimes you say, Lord, I need some better understanding. And the Lord will give it to you. But if we look at it from a carnal eye now and carnal understanding, what's going to happen? You'll find the fault. The eyes of Christ will not find fault. The eyes of man will. We're real good at it, right? We'll find it real quick, right? We'll find this splinter, right? Even that, right? How is it you find the splinter there? What about the moat? What about this 2x4 sticking out of your eye? And once again, the wood is representing humanity. Because all we're doing is we're finding humanity. We're finding carnality. No kidding. No kidding. That's what you're going to find. But it's in your own eye if that's how you're looking at it, if you're not looking at Christ, because now you've got divided vision. Who's saying that double vision? Was that Farmer?
You got double vision.
I don't want double vision. Do you want double vision? No, I want a single vision. I want the eyes of Christ. I don't want to find fault. I don't want to be woe. Because the woe really comes on us once we start doing that. And that's what he's just trying to save us from all of that. The little ones, don't offend, pluck it out, get rid of that. Man, thank God. You know, verse 14 actually just jumped out at me. It's just amazing how God is, and I do believe I wake every day looking for just a greater understanding, just a greater revelation of how wonderful our God is, how much he truly loves us. We talked about that in Sunday school this morning. All of these things are set up to show you how much God loves you. All of it. That's the heart of the Father. We talked about that. He's got nothing but good for us. We just got to look at it and see it that way. And he wants us to do that. And he says that he is revealing that. Jesus Christ said himself that he is revealing Scripture. After his resurrection, he said it is now time for the Scripture to be revealed. Because the work was completed. He went to Calvary. He did it all. He paid for every offense. You keep looking for payment. How can you look for something that's already been paid in full? He either paid for the sins of the world or he didn't. And when we say he didn't, then we start finding all the other sins and finding, listen, he paid or he didn't. Because really, that's what we say when we find offense. Somebody owes me something. I've been offended. And I can just hear Jesus whispering, I thought I paid for all of that. I thought I did. I thought I said I came to save the world. Because when we say there's an offense, you owe me something. You got to make it right. You got to fix it. We can't fix it. We couldn't fix it. It was only Jesus Christ. Verse 14 says this, even so, it is not the will of your Father, which is in heaven, that one of these little ones should perish. The will of who? Our Father in heaven? You mean it's not his will that any are going to perish? Any of the little ones are going to perish? Well, then who's perishing? It's only in our thinking, because listen, can anybody thwart the will of the Father, the will of God? You suppose if that's his will, we can change that? I mean, I don't know about you, but I don't think I can change it. You can't change that. Thank God. That's the loving God this morning. That's a loving God. None perish. That's not my will. I didn't come for that purpose. Woo! Man, thank God for that, amen? It goes on, and then this is the account with Peter. It's a very familiar account, right? Because then Peter says, well, Lord, how many times should I forgive? Seven? And I love Jesus' response. He says, until. Seven times 70. Not how many? Until. Until. Until what? Until 7 times 70. And when I saw that, the 7 times 7, I see the 49, I see Jubilee. What happens in Jubilee? All are set free. There's no more debt owed. And that's what they did during the year of Jubilee. All got set free. Slaves, there's no more debt. You set free. Everybody? Everybody. They marched around Jericho how many times? 7. They blew how many trumpets? 7. Jubilee. Did the walls come down? The walls came down. We talked about those walls, I believe, on New Year's Eve. What were those walls? Those were the offenses that I took over the course of my life, and I built up these wonderful walls around me. And every offense, whether it was my offense or your offense against me, I just kept building it and building it and building it and building me a little fortress. Until nobody could get in and Christ couldn't get out. Thank God for Jubilee. The walls came down. Until what? Until you realize all are set free by the blood of the Lamb. Now it's not how many, it's just until. I don't see an offense. I don't know what you're talking about. That's what Jesus Christ was saying there. What offense? What do you mean how many? You're asking the wrong question, Peter. Until. Until you open your eyes and see. 7 times 7. It's also Daniel's 70 weeks. You read Daniel chapter 9. He talks about the 70 weeks. You know what happens after the 70 weeks? There's no more transgressions. There's no more offenses. There's no more sin. Man, that's a good place to be. And that's what he's saying here. There's no more offenses. There is no more sin. There's no more trespass. Until. And then he talks about the kingdom of heaven is likened unto a certain king, which would take account of his servants. And when he had begun to reckon, one was brought unto him which owed him 10,000 talents. But for as much as he had not to pay, the Lord commanded him to be sold, his wife, his children, and all that he had, and the payment to be made. The servant fell before him and worshipped him, saying, Lord, have patience with me, I will pay thee all. Then the Lord of the servant was moved with compassion and loosed him and forgave him all his debt. The kingdom of heaven is. The kingdom of heaven is what? The kingdom of heaven is your heavenly Father forgiving you of all your debt. 10,000 talents. That word 10,000 is actually the Greek word myrios. It's actually not 10,000 the way we know it. It actually is without number. Myrios is where we get the word myriad. Myriad. You can't number it. You can't number it. You couldn't pay it. It wasn't $10,000. It was you can't pay it. The debt you can't pay. That's the kingdom of heaven. There's a king. Guess what? He just forgave it all. Because you couldn't pay it. He had compassion. He had mercy. Mercy. Our God had mercy. He forgave it all. He forgave it all. And now what happens to that servant? Servant leaves and says, oh, thank you, Lord. And then he found the one that owed him what? 100 denarii. He owed him a day's wages. He says, he grabbed him by the throat. Pay me what you owe me, man. Where was the mercy? Isn't that funny, too? He owed him a day's wages. He owed him a few bucks. This guy, we owe 10,000 talents. He owed him a few bucks, he grabbed him by the throat. I want to choke the life out of him. Because isn't that the truth, too, when we find when there's an offense? Sometimes the restitution's made, or, hey, you know, you broke my cup, oh, here's a new cup. And it's not good enough, we want to choke the life out of him. Because you can't satisfy that carnal nature. And that's what he's talking about there when he's grabbing the throat. You can't satisfy that appetite. There's nothing to satisfy that. He's looking to redeem you from that, to get you away from that, because you can't satisfy it. Because you do. A little offense, and you want... And God says, listen, I have mercy. I mean, the debt was insurmountable. I have nothing but compassion and mercy. And it goes on to say in the end of this passage, when the servant didn't forgive him, he said, shouldst not thou have had compassion on thy fellow servant, even as I have pity on you? So now he's asking the question. I mean, I gave you mercy. I gave you compassion. Shouldn't you have done likewise? Shouldn't you have done the same thing? And of course he didn't. And the Lord was wroth and delivered him to his tormentors till he should pay all that was due him. The tormentors. He's delivering him to some tormentors? Anybody ever been delivered to some tormentors? And what is he saying there? Again, the torment is here. It's also when we talked about that with the rich man and Lazarus, right? That he was tormented. And to torment the stone, you realize what the true nature is. And that's how they would test the gold. They would torment the stone. So that's what God's doing. He says, listen, I'm going to turn you back over to your tormentor. Because really, where is the when we're tormented, where is it? If somebody offends me, Where is it? It's up here. I'm tormented. Okay? Now, I can forgive him. I don't have to live with that torment. I don't have to live with the woe. But when I don't do that, what happens? In my father's house, there are many mansions, and let me add a prison to it so I can stick this person in it. Oh, no, yeah. In my father's house, there are many mansions. There's no prison in that mansion. The heart of the father doesn't have any prison. But you don't forgive. You hold on to that offense. You just created a prison. And it's inside your head, and you will be tormented. And eventually, God will bring us to the place where you do have a revelation, you have understanding. And you will forgive, just like he did. You will have compassion, just like he did. And that's what he's saying there. Because then he goes on to say, so likewise shall my heavenly Father do also unto you, if ye from your hearts forgive not every one of his brother their trespasses. And that word trespass, it actually does mean that. It means a lapse from the truth. It's when I don't act in my true nature, my true character, which is the Spirit of Christ that's inside me. It's just a momentary lapse from the truth. From the truth. And so when I see that in my life, I don't get offended. I say, Lord, forgive them, for they know not. It's just a momentary lapse from the truth of who they truly are. And he says that, right? In Proverbs, mercy and truth go hand in hand. They go together. They said they're tied around your neck. You do have them both, mercy and truth. Because really, you have to have the truth if you're going to live this life. Truth has to come along. I can't live the lie. If I live the lie, I'm going to be tormented. Thank God for the truth. Thank God he is the way, the truth. I bear witness to the truth. Why? So you won't be tormented. You have to have truth. Because otherwise, I'm just going to live apart from the truth. I still collapse from it. And so the truth has to accompany it now. It has to accompany it. You know, when I saw this passage, I thought about Daniel. You know, and Daniel, of course, was, you know, a man of God. But it says that the princes and the presidents and the governors and the counselors and the captains, they couldn't find fault in him. So they said, we've got to look at the law of his God. We've got to look at the law to find the offense. And they created a law. And, of course, Daniel, what did he do? Well, their law said that he couldn't worship any other king other than the king at that time. And, of course, he worshiped the true king. And what did they do? Well, he broke the law. There's the offense. We found it. They also created it. And they found it. And I love that, because what did Daniel do, really? Daniel didn't do anything. He was praying. He loved God and he was praying. What did Jesus do? He just loved. He was kind. He was compassionate. What did they do? Same thing that they did to Daniel. We're going to throw you in the lion's den. And I do find there's significance in the fact that there were presidents, princes, governors, counselors, and captains. There were five different groups. Our five senses. What we see, what we hear, what we touch, what we feel. And they're going to cast him in. You see, because that's what he's trying to free us from. Because the senses, our emotions, will always find fault. And there's no stability in it. There is no stability in that. That's not the truth. That's not truth. It may be a fact, but it's not truth. I don't live my life based on a set of facts. I live my life based on a truth. Based on what's real, not what is not. And so that's what I see with essentially those five groups. It's just when we do live in this natural sense, because then we'll find the offenses. But Jesus says, be not offended. But they found the offense. And of course, what did? They cast him into the lion's den. They cast him into the lion's den. But you know what was interesting? When I read that passage also, it says that the king, he was all messed up, man. And he went in the morning when he woke up and he couldn't sleep well because he knew. Because it also said Daniel had an excellent spirit. Even there now, in case people are wondering, no, the Spirit of God was inside of Daniel. The Spirit of God has always been inside of man. He can't make man without his spirit. So he had the excellent spirit. The king may not have had an understanding of what it was, but he realized it was something greater. And he ran to him and he cried out, Daniel! He said, hey, I'm here. It's all good, man. Chill. Don't sweat it, man. And you know what he said? He said, the Lord has found me to be innocent. And you too, King. He set the king free, man. You're innocent. Daniel, I threw you into the lion's den. You're innocent, King. It was just a lapse from the truth. Because the same excellent spirit I have, King, you have. You just didn't realize it. And so he says, hey, I'm innocent. God's found me innocent. He's found you innocent too. Man, that is beautiful. You mean I haven't offended you? Nope. No, you're innocent. And of course, David wasn't touched. His lions couldn't touch him. And we're talking about the lion, the adversary. It's just a carnal thinking. I think it's in Amos that says that the shepherd shall redeem from the mouth of the lion the legs and the ear. What about the rest of it? See, God needs our legs. He needs our walk. He needs the lifestyle. And he also needs your ear so that you will hear from him. The lion's not going to move you. The lion ain't going to scare you. It ain't going to matter. He is freeing you from that lion. But I love that. What is he redeeming? My walk, my ear, so I can hear from God, so I can wake up in the morning and look for the good news and say, Lord, what do you have for me today? Here's what I got, Philip. Here is the way. Walk ye in it. Oh, okay. No offense today, Phil. None. See, you can live that life today, right now. Jesus Christ said so. So either we're going to hold on to that truth or say, I just don't have that much power inside of me. I don't have the power to forgive. I don't have the power to walk that walk. I don't have the power to have that ear. That's not a truth. Because his word says you do. His word says you can do that. And that's power. It's God. It's a power from God that dwells inside of us to do that. That, to me, is just so incredible. You have that power this morning. You have the power to be like Daniel and say, I'm innocent. You're innocent. What lion is that? I don't know what you're talking about. My God's got it under control. There was no fear. There was no worry. There was no doubt in Daniel. Why? Because he had an excellent spirit inside of him. The same excellent spirit you have inside of you. The one that says, mercy. Mercy. You believe that this morning? Amen. I'm going to ask the worship team if they'll come back up. Sing that song again. The presence is heaven. You know, James 3 says that, first of all, love is kind. It also says that this wisdom that is from above, the same wisdom you have access to, it is full of mercy. Let me ask you a question this morning. Are you full of mercy? If I were to pour you out like a bottle, what would come out of you? Anything but mercy? See, wisdom from above says I'm full of mercy. I'm just like Daniel. I don't know what you're talking about. I don't see the offense. You're innocent. Mercy. Mercy. You can live that life today. All that stuff, whatever you walked in here with, that paper, yesterday's news, man. You're full of mercy this morning. Pour it out. I'm innocent. You're innocent. That's what the cross did. We're all innocent. Hateful. But that wisdom is from above. It's from God and only by God. By God's design. But he gave it to you. He says you're full of mercy. You can pour that out. Peter also says love does what? It covers a multitude of sin. That's the heart of a father. What offense? I cover it. That word multitude. Once again, it's like myriad. You can't even count them. I don't see the offense. That's what you're full of this morning. Mercy. Just the mercy of God. That's the heart of the Father. You believe that this morning? Amen. Why don't you stand with me this morning?